Hello, thank you for joining us for today's webinar, Why Your RDBMS Fails at Scale. My name is Kim Lewis, and I'll be your host for today's event. If you have any questions throughout our presentation, please submit them through the Q&A widget, which is located on the left side of your screen. We'll address any content-related questions at the end of the presentation, but we do encourage you to please let us know if you're having any technical difficulties with the platform so that we can help troubleshoot those right away. If at any time your slides seem to stop progressing, do please try refreshing your browser, and also note that today's audio is being streamed. So if you're having any difficulty hearing any of the presentation, try adjusting the audio on your computer or your mobile device and not the media player that's in your left side of your screen. We'd also like you to invite to explore and download the resources related to today's topic on the left side of your screen, as well as the speaker bios on the right. Without any further ado, I'd like to introduce today's speakers. Jeff Carpenter is a technical evangelist at DataStax, where he leverages his background in system architecture, microservices, and Apache Cassandra to help empower developers and operations engineers. Thanks for joining us, Jeff.
Yeah, I'm glad to be here.
And I'd also like to welcome Andrew Lampitt, who heads product marketing for DataStax. Prior to DataStax, Andrew has held a variety of senior roles in sales, marketing, and business development with companies like TIBCO and Business Objects. Welcome, Andrew.
Thank you very much, Kim. So I'll go ahead and get underway. So thank you, everyone, for joining. And I'd like to set the context for you as we would launch the presentation and give you an intro as to what we're going to cover. So first of all, this webinar is specifically about why the RDBMS cannot handle scale, and we'll talk about different techniques that folks use to try to overcome scale requirements. So I'm going to launch off with, first of all, we're going to cover about 20 slides. I'll start off giving an introduction about DataStax for those of you who are not aware, and then I'll hand it over to Jeff, who will get into some of the nitty-gritty the technical aspects, architecturally speaking, and theoretically speaking, on the differences of RDBMS versus DataStax Enterprise. And then I'll take it back from Jeff and close out over the following few slides. So to start off with, especially a lot of folks who may not be aware of DataStax, here's a quick overview about the company itself. So we've come a long way very quickly from 2010 when we launched as a company. So now we have about 400 employees, nearly $200 million in funding, and more than 500 customers. And there you see some of the leading brands in the world represented: Netflix, McDonald's, Comcast, Safeway, etc. And there you see some industry recognition below from Forbes, being recognized the last couple of years in terms of the top 100 cloud companies. And Gartner has a great report that came out late last year. I invite you to take a look about critical capabilities. DataStax scored number one in multiple operational database categories. So come to our website and get that report and download it. It's a good read. So I want to take a step back and inform you of really the mission around DataStax. Who are we serving and for what? We're specifically about those cloud applications that are being delivered to millions of users around the world. And what's happening is those users and devices are interacting from many different aspects, and those people and devices expect not only a very responsive experience, but also an always-on experience. If something goes down for even 5 or 10 minutes, it can cost not only millions of dollars of business, but it can also irreparably damage the reputation of the company. And so more and more these days, we're relying on the moments that drive an experience, and that's where we take the tagline for DataStax: we're the power behind the moment. Now, when we speak of these cloud applications, I want to describe some characteristics associated to those cloud applications. It's not enough to think, oh, okay, you know, we've had the web for a while, and it's just, you know, solving the criteria of a web application using Java or whatever kind of database. Nope, that's not the point at all. When you start thinking about a cloud application and serving thousands and millions of users and devices on a worldwide basis without any downtime, they're all pointing to these kinds of characteristics. We use a simple acronym within data science called CARDS. So as you see these words below, the first letter of each phrase is spelling out CARDS. So contextual, what that means is the information needs to be provided to the user or to the device in a relevant fashion. So give only the information that's exactly appropriate at the right moment. The second one, always on, that is continuous availability. You might have heard of a phrase, high availability. That simply won't cut it these days. It needs to be continuously available. That is always available, always uptime. Real time, you know, we're speaking of the responsiveness required, particularly for a business application. We're not talking about the difference of milliseconds and microseconds. It is, you know, if I'm a business user, you know, and I'm using the application, whether I'm in North America or Europe, I want that application to give a great responsive experience. It should be, you know, say, for example, within a half a second or something like that. Distributed, you know, now we're speaking of applications that have to be deployed and distributed, not only across different devices, but perhaps different cloud regions, maybe between a data center and a public cloud, so a hybrid cloud scenario. The point is this workload is not confined to one region, one data center, or one cluster. It's spanning a lot of geographically dispersed areas. And then finally, scalable. So probably heard of the aspect of scaling up. You know, you're adding memory or making a bigger machine. That just won't cut it nowadays either. You need to scale across these different regions. You need to scale out in a very efficient manner. And Jeff will elaborate on that a little bit more as well. So I'd like to, you know, give you a flavor of what we're talking about in terms of the real world with a few example customers. First one, a very well-known customer of DataStacks is Netflix. So they literally have thousands of nodes of DataStacks deployed. And of course, if a customer wants to watch a movie, they want to watch a movie now. They don't want to, oh, the system's down, no problem, it's Friday night, got to wait until the maintenance is done, and we'll take a look at the movie tomorrow morning. What? No, it's got to be in that moment. And so, you know, the problems of data set of Netflix were tried to be solved with an RDBMS, with Oracle. It simply didn't work when they got to scale problems of, for example, having multiple accounts per family. You know, once you have that challenge, you went from one account per family to now say 2, 3, 5, 7 accounts per family. So you have a lot more workload requirement. Likewise, when they had the recommendations list, that was another challenge. And all those problems proposed or introduced new scale issues. And they wanted to have the always-on capabilities with that scale. And DataStacks was able to solve it for them. So Microsoft, you know, you might have heard of Microsoft SharePoint. Very successful solution, but then moving to the cloud, you have a whole new level of scale required. So I'm speaking specifically of Microsoft Office 365, where the product management said, you know, what we want to do is get ahead of the user's experience. We want to be able to serve the best experience, and then if something might be on its way to going wrong, we want to be able to get ahead of that and give them a better experience. What that means is you need to have a lot of real-time analytics going on as you're collecting data about that user experience. And so what Microsoft was able to do was use DataStacks Enterprise to collect that information, analyze it, and make sure that the best experience is made available to the consumer. There's a very successful case study article written up on our website, even on Microsoft's website. I invite you to take a look to download as well. Walmart, you know, great example of I need scale and I need the scale to handle unpredictability. So whether it's a phenomenal surge in traffic requirements like Walmart has seen the past four Black Fridays in a row, or a catastrophic failure. You know, we've had other customers who say, I've lost a data center. There was a hurricane, wiped it out. I still retained uptime. So whether it's catastrophic failure or whether it's huge growth that's unpredictable, DataStax Enterprise can deliver. So first, I want to be clear. We're not discounting the viability and credibility of an RDBMS. It has its place. It's a phenomenal technology. It's driving, you know, the world's businesses today, right? It is a very specific context, and it's a historical context, though. And so let's put that into frame for you. So first, you know, we're talking about relatively really small or medium operational data. So very commonly, it's going to be fitting on one machine. We're talking about hundreds of users. Typically, it may be up to thousands, but typically hundreds of users. Of course, very primarily structured. That's what it's all about. Requires the ACID guarantees, and Jeff is going to elaborate on those in just a moment. You want to have SQL as your language for queries, for example. And you're perfectly fine with scaling up to add more memory, to make it a bigger, more robust machine. Just add the more hardware. Well, that's been, you could say, the traditional story, particularly in the client-server days, and then into the web days of the 2000s. But what we're seeing increasingly is that cloud applications are disrupting business as usual. So now we're in this cloud paradigm. Now we're not talking about only many more users. We're talking about many more devices. We're talking about Internet of Things. For example, they say, you know, cars are becoming data centers on wheels. So you've got all of this data operating in all these different devices with all these different people with different ways to access the data. Jeff is going to elaborate on this architecture a little bit later, too, and kind of peel it apart and show you how the client layer and the data layer have evolving requirements that need to be able to scale out. So with that, Jeff, I'd like to hand it over to you.
Thanks a lot, Andrew. So as we're talking about scaling out our client level and our application tier, we also need to think about scaling out our database, of course. And over the years, there have been a number of techniques that have been developed to help us try to scale, to attempt to scale those relational databases. What we've found, though, is that there's a big challenge in being able to continue to have the guarantees that people have come to expect with relational databases. It's really hard to maintain those guarantees in this distributed computing kind of world. So this slide makes kind of a bold statement that ACID is a lie once you have data replication. So let me unpack that and justify this statement a little bit. If I could take you back through these principles of transactional behavior in relational databases, we like to think about these ACID semantics in terms of atomicity, consistency, isolation, and durability. So let me walk you through a scenario here that shows how these guarantees begin to break down when you have data replication and distribution. So let's say that we have a client that has a read-heavy workload, and so we're going to add asynchronous replication. We have a master-slave architecture here in which writes are made to the master, and then those writes are propagated from the master out to the slave nodes in the architecture. So this is a really common architecture, and one of the nice things about it is that there's only one place to write. We're not even talking about writing to multiple locations. We are just talking about shifting some of that read load off of that master onto some slaves. So this is not a super aggressive distributed computing architecture. It's pretty common. However, even this will begin to break down under stress. So for example, let's say a client decides to do a read. from one of these slaves before the data gets replicated. So whatever lag exists in the replication from the master to the slave is a window in which a client can read obsolete data, so they are not reading the latest data. Or atomicity is also a problem in this case, because let's say that we are having writes that are occurring to multiple tables. Each of those writes to different tables must be synchronized out to the slave. It is possible, in theory, for that client to get the latest from some tables and not from another. So the original transaction committed successfully on the master, but if there's any lag in terms of the tables that constitute that transaction, if they get out of sync in terms of how quickly they're replicated to the slaves, then we have a problem with atomicity. Similarly, we are losing this principle of isolation in which a client is able to get obsolete data. And if we think about this in terms of a client that is doing a read after write, which we like to avoid in our applications when possible, but it's probably more commonly exercised than not that a client will immediately do a read after it has written data. We can have a durability problem here if the client ends up doing its read from one of the slaves. It could have just written data, and then it's immediately trying to read it back, and it won't get the latest data. So this is a violation of the durability principle. So, and again, in this situation, I haven't even talked about the idea of having sort of a multi-master architecture when you can write to multiple nodes. What we really need to do is take a step back and think about the CAP theorem. This is a very useful theorem. It's been much debated over the years, but I would say that the basic principles that it embody are very much still alive and well and with us. So this is the theorem that Eric Brewer first articulated in the early 2000s. And this theorem basically states that we have consistency, availability, and partition tolerance, or the ability to tolerate a break in our network connection between nodes. So these three principles, we would like to have them all guaranteed at 100% in our architecture. As it turns out, the nature of the distributed systems and networks with faults, et cetera, is that we cannot have 100% guarantee of all three of these. And the traditional way to think about the CAP theorem has been pick two. You can have any two out of three, but then you have to in order to have 100% guarantee of any two, then you have to be willing to make a trade-off on that third leg of the triangle, if you visualize this as being arranged in a triangle. So in the relational database world, we have made a choice that strong consistency is king, and this is embodied by the focus on having ACID semantics for our transactions. So we've chosen that over high availability. What a relational database, the choice that has been made is I will accept that write to a node, and if this means that I do not have the data immediately available on another node, such as a replicated slave, then that's the sacrifice that we make. What we see differently in this NoSQL world with databases like Cassandra and other databases that have been designed for internet scale is that a different set of trade-offs is possible. So Cassandra embodies something that we call tunable consistency. This allows us to emphasize high availability and partition tolerance, and we have flexibility, or the area in which we are making trade-offs is in how much consistency we require. So it's a bit of a different design choice. So in contrasting relational and NoSQL databases like Cassandra, we have data that's replicated asynchronously across multiple data centers. And the limiting factor here is the speed of light. So we acknowledge that we have a lot of times we're talking about companies with global footprint that need a database that runs on data centers which are distributed around the world. We acknowledge the speed of light and the transmission times across these global networks. But in order to have that data locality with near real-time replication in multiple data centers around the world, that we're going to emphasize high availability so that data is present and we're going to make some sacrifices in terms of instantaneous consistency. And that's a useful trade-off to make, and it's what allows us to scale to global proportions. Now, that's not to say that sometimes people get confused and they think, okay, so Cassandra is giving up on consistency or throwing it out the window. That's not exactly what's happening. What we talk about in terms of eventual consistency or tunable consistency is a lot of times people forget that the eventual part of eventual consistency is on the order of milliseconds. So we are talking about these are things that are happening in neural time that are the consistency is being guaranteed in a fairly short time frame. And we can dive later into some of the mechanisms that Cassandra provides on top of its base functionality that allow you in certain cases to get a little bit more consistency. So again, comparing and contrasting relational versus NoSQL databases, the way that we scale or traditionally have scaled with relational world is what we call vertical scalability. And what do I mean? I mean, well, I can scale up my relational database by buying a bigger machine. Bigger hardware servers, more memory, more CPU, more storage. This can get quite expensive. So this begins, there's a point at which this breaks down and your ability to vertically scale just kind of runs into the practical limits of what computers are available on today's market. So the way that we traditionally scale on in the NoSQL world is really that we run with a footprint of commodity servers that are lower cost, not the most high-end machines, is often turns out to be the most economical case for running Cassandra. So we have a large number of those machines. We scale out horizontally. We are able to do this because Cassandra features a masterless architecture. So the reality of this world, and especially in the cloud computing environment, and if you're running on a vendor, say like an Amazon Web Services, AWS, AWS shuts down instances all the time, often with very little notice. If you're running in an environment like that, you need to be able to survive the loss of a node. Machines fail, physical hardware dies, virtual machines are killed, and this is the reality of this cloud computing world. So Cassandra responds very well to this adding and removing of nodes. And instead of it being a manual process to reallocate your data across multiple nodes in a cluster, this is handled automatically by Cassandra. So again, contrasting with the relational world where sharding can tend to be a very manual process and require a lot of hands-on operational maintenance if you want to add or remove nodes or add additional slaves. This is something that is designed into the architecture of Cassandra that it handles from the ground up. So let's talk about sharding. Let's get real about sharding. In the relational world, sharding is a technique that was bolted on later. That's not to say that it, you know, wasn't a clever and effective engineering technique. And you know, Cassandra uses something like sharding in that data is partitioned and spread across multiple machines. There's some challenges with it, though, in the relational world. One of the things is that in a relational world, a lot of the data modeling paradigms and your application level access patterns are based on denormalized tables, and oftentimes in order to build up the set of data that your application needs on a read, we're actually querying across multiple tables and doing a join. If you think about what this looks like in a relational database world where you have a sharding technique, this means that your joins are actually going to require making basically full cluster scans across multiple tables in order to collect together the data that you have. And similarly with secondary indexes, if you're doing a query on a relational database with a secondary index, what used to be on a single node, a simple lookup, you're querying an index that's spread across, where your data is spread across multiple nodes in a cluster. Now we have to do an index lookup on just about, or perhaps every single one of those notes. So this is extremely non-performant, and this begins to be the big barrier to scalability. Not to mention this idea of manually maintaining shards and reallocating data. There is some tooling in some areas that can improve this, but historically it has been more of a manual process. And schema changes can be painful because now, again, we're not just doing a schema change on a single node, but we're doing it on multiple nodes. So how are we going to keep all of these schema changes synchronized and make sure that they all fire on all of those replicated nodes at the same time? So I like that Andrew mentioned before this idea that, you know, for cloud scale applications, high availability is not enough. This is an age in which we need continuous availability. How would you do that in a relational database architecture? If you think about what the maintenance life cycle looks like, if you need to take a node down in order to perform maintenance of it, that's a challenge with a relational database. So that's for planned outages. What about unplanned outages? Let's say you do have a node that goes down. Your ability to have high availability on your relational database then depends on your ability to detect that outage of that particular node. How quickly can you detect and then perform your maintenance and recover that node? Because of how Apache Cassandra is designed, because it's a masterless architecture, it automatically is survivable of a couple of nodes, depending on what kind of replication factor you've set, which really says, how many copies of my data do I need per data center? You can then, based on how many replicas that you've asked for, and the most common number is 3, that means that you'll be able to survive up to two outages of nodes that happen to have your data within a cluster. So there's if you need more than that, then you can request additional replicas. And again, this is just to summarize a couple of more things that we haven't had a chance to talk about yet in terms of the challenges of having large-scale distributed databases. In the relational world, what you tend to see most often is that single location write to a single master. And in Cassandra, you have the ability to write to any node. Because the nodes are all completely peer-to-peer, there is no master, no node that is the only node that can accept a write on a particular table or a particular row. Any node that is a replica can accept that write. And in fact, you can even perform writes on nodes that don't own data because they're able to store data as hints and forward it to other nodes later. So there's a lot of redundancy mechanisms that are built into the core architecture of Cassandra that make it more resilient. And there's the ability to scale to many thousands of columns is present. It's not a shortcoming of Cassandra like it is for many relational databases. So to circle back to what Andrew was mentioning before, we think about the scale of the computing environments where we're deploying our applications. In the 1990s, we had this popular client-server architecture where I might have a desktop application that's talking to a single server. The web changed the paradigm for all of us, in which we were taking advantage of the internet to serve up applications over the internet, and scaling up on the server side was a big deal, scaling up to multiple servers to serve multiple clients. Now, fast forward to today's world, where, as Andrew mentioned, we're adding more and more clients, more and more computing environments, places that didn't have computers before, like our cars and our phones and our personal devices. We have wearing computers on our bodies. So many more nodes in our extremely networked world. So we know how to scale out devices. We know how to scale out our application tier. Have we yet figured out how to scale out our database, our data layer that is underneath that? Vertical scaling is not going to get us there. We need that horizontal scalability, and that's really what Apache Cassandra is going to provide for us.
Okay. Thanks, Jeff. Great overview. So, you know, taking off from where Jeff left off, you know, we really did crack that nut with DataStacks. That nut to crack was, how do you achieve full horizontal scalability on the on the whole stack? The application stack was already solved, and DataStacks has solved that scaling out on the data layer side. So I'll offer you a little background of DataStacks and our, you could think of it as our evolution over the past several years since 2010. So the project of Apache Cassandra was born out of Facebook. Since that time, DataStacks has taken the lead in being the shepherd for Apache Cassandra, and a very strong one at that. We've contributed the bulk of the commits to Apache Cassandra. So there you see the number. It's around 85%, 85 plus percent of the commits are actually from DataStacks. Likewise, if you're familiar with the graph world, we've contributed virtually all of the Apache Tinkerpop code as well. So that's just to show that we have very strong open source and data innovation roots, and all of that having to do with scale, with really managing data at scale and designing systems for scale. As we've evolved, we first wanted to start and make that Apache Cassandra technology successful in its own right and viable. And once that was achieved, we also moved on then to make sure the community was enabled. So when you go to the DataStacks website, you can register for DataStacks Academy and get free online training to understand how to use Apache Cassandra. Essentially, it's really the behind-the-scenes technology, but you're learning how to use DataStacks Enterprise. And that's all free online training. Since that time, you know, I showed you some of the logos that represent the innovative brands that rely on DataStacks. More and more, they're requesting enterprise-grade features and really fleshing out the platform for their requirements in a unified platform of not just database, but also search, analytics, adding more data model capabilities such as graph. So that what you see there listed on the right under DataStacks Enterprise 5.0 and 5.1 are some of those examples as to how now we're providing those features on a commercial level directly to customers. So customers can benefit from these features, and we're tailoring them to their specific requirements. That's with respect to both features added on the core database, complementary features such as search and analytics that round out the data platform, as well as performance. You're going to see more and more differentiation of performance, both with respect to the analytics versus open source, as well as the core database itself. So, you know, what's the difference in a picture? Well, here it is. There's a ton. So DataStacks Enterprise, you know, you really need to think of it as an enterprise-grade data platform. And what I mean by that is just simply look at the checkboxes of those features and capabilities associated that DataStacks Enterprise fulfills. As opposed to Apache Cassandra, it's a great open-source database technology, but it is a technology. It's not an enterprise-grade database. So what happens with DataStacks Enterprise, what you receive is the same masterless architecture that Jeff had described, extended multi-model capabilities, including graph. And we point out that it's the best distribution of Apache Cassandra because all of those hot fixes and bug escalations, we do that for you. We certify the service packs. We provide platform certification. We QA it all at the scale. When you're relying on an open source project, all of that is left up to you to pick the right versions, to scrutinize the different patches, and then to maintain all that. Well, we take care of that for you. So other items mentioned as I did on the prior screen in terms of performance and features. I'd like to point out also that there's a great deal of simplicity included in the platform. That's with respect to developers in terms of developer tooling with DataStacks Enterprise Studio. as well as for administrators. We provide administration and monitoring capabilities in Ops Center. And what that means is you can visually, graphically manage your clusters, and you can treat those as a unit as opposed to managing the individual nodes as you would if you did not use Ops Center. Of course, all of this is backed up by us, the experts. That's in terms of commercial support, 24/7, 365, as well as providing different capabilities for checkups for the performance, for example, and health of the environment. And as a reminder, not only the online training that I mentioned is free, we do have training in person, of course, as well. So I gave you a little bit of a sampler of some of the logos that are using DataStax Enterprise at the beginning of the presentation. This gives you a little bit bigger view. And again, what you'll notice is we really handle the world's leading brands. These are large enterprises. So whenever someone has a data management challenge at scale for operational data management, for mixed workloads, that is operational data management plus operational analytics, combined, it is our sweet spot, and that's who we serve. Here we are at the final slide for the key takeaways. So remember, DataStax is the power behind the moment, and why your RDBMS fails at scale is summarized there for you that Jeff covered. Consistency and all the other ACID aspects are really not practical. In fact, in some cases, just not possible. Manual sharding is hard, and resharding it is hard. Also, maintaining it, maybe that's something we can cover in Q&A, Jeff. If something does go down when you shard, what does that mean with respect to administration and kind of recovering things? Scaling is expensive. The master-slave architecture adds complexity and hinders the continuous availability and scalability. And then finally, I did wrap up with the leading brands covering DataStax, relying on DataStax for their globally distributed data management challenges. So next steps, I would invite you to download DataStax at our website. Register for DataStax Academy. It's a fantastic resource to get free online training. There's a lot of great coursework that kind of walks you through the different aspects of development and deployment, data model design considerations, for example. So with that, I'd like to move to a Q&A session. And so I think we have some questions coming in here. So the first one, I'm going to toss this to you, Jeff. It's with respect to transactions. It says, so I'm not understanding, are you handling transactions or not? You want to take that, Jeff?
Sure. So I don't mean to say that Cassandra doesn't support transactions at all. It does support transactions, but it does not provide those full ACID semantics. So first of all, there is a technique known as batching. So you can take a couple of mutation statements, like an insert or an update, to multiple tables, and you can put them together in a batch. So that Cassandra will guarantee that if one of those succeeds, then all of them will succeed. And that's with respect to eventual consistency. So Cassandra will make that guarantee to you that if it's going to accept any of those writes, it will accept them all, and that they will all eventually make their way to all the nodes. The second is there is a lightweight transaction mechanism that is built into Cassandra. It's based on a consensus protocol known as the Paxos algorithm, and that has been adopted into Cassandra so that you can have linearizable writes into a single partition or a single table. So you can't get an ACID transaction that spans multiple tables. That's not something that Cassandra is signing up to provide. But if you need to have that isolated write on a specific table, then you can get those semantics. And the example that I like to use to describe this is, let's say we're tracking inventory, and I would like to decrement the count of inventory for a particular product. I'm able to construct a write command that's, and this is in CQL, which is our version of SQL, essentially. It's a subset of what you have in SQL. You can construct a statement in the Cassandra query language that basically says, I would like to update the inventory count to 5, but only if the inventory count is currently 6. So I can get those semantics where I've been able to guarantee there that I didn't have an intervening write that, you know, took the last product off of the shelf out from underneath me in between a read and a write that I might have performed. We can give semantics in those very limited circumstances. And that's one of the things that I like about Cassandra is that it doesn't overpromise and underdeliver. So it is conservative and gives you the guarantees that it can give you, and then allows you to handle any stronger semantics than that at kind of at the application level or even in terms of your business processes.
Okay, great. Next question here is, can you elaborate on the best expectations for real-time that DataStax can deliver?
Sure. Well, since we are talking about cases where we have replication that might involve data centers that are around the world, basically, we can't get any faster than the speed of light. So, you know, you have a network hop that goes under the ocean between a couple of different data centers. We are not going to be able to guarantee consistency any more quickly than that. So there is that limiting factor there. So when you think about those network latencies that get involved in some of those longer hops, that actually turns out to be more of the dominating factor in how long it takes for your database to be consistent as opposed to just storage within a single data center, which is on the order of a small number of milliseconds in most cases.
Okay, I just commented later about the maintenance aspects of sharding. If a shard goes, you know, a deployment goes down with sharding, can you comment on that a little bit more? About, you know, it's hard enough to design a thing. But what about maintaining? You know, if nodes go down, like you were talking about, nodes can go down all the time. So why don't you comment on that?
Sure. Yeah. Well, you know, manual maintenance of that. I think the hardest part of rebalancing, let's say, because that's what you're really looking for is rebalancing. You're wanting to make sure that you do not have one of the nodes that is responsible for data that is carrying too much of the load. So with a manual sharding case, those are calculations that you're going to have to take into account yourself. What data can be moved off of a node that's underperforming or has gone down? Which of that data can be moved in order to not overly load another node to which that data is being moved? So those are calculations that occur automatically in Cassandra, because one of the great things about Cassandra is that it's designed with that expectation of failure. So if you think about some of these classic relational databases, which they were designed to work on one machine, and then the recovery techniques were grafted on later, Cassandra is the opposite. It's designed with the assumption that things are going to fail. So those protocols and algorithms are there as a central element of the design because we expect things to fail and that we're going to have to recover. So it's innate within the architecture.
Great. Good soundbite there that it's designed with the understanding that hardware is going to fail. So don't hope and pray that it's not going to. Design it understanding that it's likely to happen. So I think that's a great point to stop, Kim. And we can wrap it up from there.
Great. Thank you so much, Andrew and Jeff. We'd like to conclude today's webinar, most of all, by thanking all of you for joining us today. We hope you gained a better understanding about why relational databases fail when it comes to handling distributed cloud applications and what you should be considering when it comes to investigating alternative solutions. If you'd like to take a closer look at our products, we invite you to register for one of our Thursday weekly webinars where we take a closer look at DataStax Enterprise and DataStax Managed Cloud, including capabilities such as graph, analytics, and search. There's a link in the resources widget if you're interested in registering. Once again, I'd like to thank you for joining us and hope you have a wonderful day.